Last year, we saw trade and geopolitical risks dominate the headlines. This year, 2020 has started off with the coronavirus outbreak. First Nations, and protest groups blocking ports in Vancouver and disrupting travel through VIA. Are the headlines different in 2020 when it comes to impacting the economy?
Yeah, that's a very good question. First of all, clearly trade is not dominating the agenda, at least not for now. Trump was able to do this phase one agreement with China that will remove, at least on a temporary basis, the uncertainty about trade. Now, we have to be clear, it's not over by any stretch of the imagination. This is a Mickey Mouse type agreement. This is a Trump type agreement where you deal with the easy part, not with the difficult part. So this will come back to visit probably by the end of the year towards 2021, after the elections, exactly what Trump would like to see. So this is not over, this is just we postponed the trade situation as a source of uncertainty now. Clearly, what's happening with the virus is a major factor, and we don't know, nobody really knows what will happen. However, if you compare the current situation to SARS, we know a few things. First, China is much bigger now than it was in 2003. That is much more significant factor impacting the global economy. Also, China back then was able to stimulate the economy. Exports were rising by 25%, not the case today. Also, the global stock market back then was actually very low, looking for an excuse to go up. Today, the opposite is the case. The stock market, record high, looking for an excuse to go down, and the virus is helping here. So that's the background. But if you look at the impact on Canada, it's not as significant so far as it was with SARS. One, because we don't know how significant it will be yet. We see China moving very, very quickly to stop it. That's something that we haven't seen in 2003. And as far as the impact on oil prices, the oil sector is not doing so great to start with, so the impact here is not so negative. So overall, if it stops over the next 2 to 3 months, we'll be fine. If it continues for the next 6 months, then it will start impacting supply chain space globally, and clearly will impact the Canadian economy. So far, the damage is not as significant. You don't see this panic that we have seen in 2003 after SARS. People are going to restaurants. Retail sales are not being impacted in any significant way. So far, so good as far as the economy is concerned. 2, 3, 4 months from now, it will start impacting supply chains. That will be a different story.
Very similar comments, made by our finance minister, Bill Morneau, recently. The finance minister also said that our economy is doing well. Is the government underplaying what is happening with the Canadian economy?
Well, the economy is not doing so great. Let's start by saying that. Overall economic growth today is maybe 1.5% if we are lucky. We haven't seen really strong economic growth over the past 6 months. So the labor market is strong. But if you look at retail sales, consumer spending is now at a rate that in the past was consistent with lower interest rates, not higher interest rates. Clearly, the energy sector is not doing great. Exports not rising in any significant way. Our savings rate is not high enough compared to the US. So I would not say that the economy is doing great. Now, the potential growth of the economy, the speed limit of the economy has been reduced because of demographic forces. So even if you're at 1.5% GDP growth, you're very close to your potential. But this potential is not too high to start with.
Where are you getting growth from, economic growth? I mean, if you're seeing household spending, I guess, in low gear, housing has now maybe, you know, kind of tapered off. Where is the economy going to see growth from?
That's a good question. And the answer is, we don't know. We don't see the consumer carrying this economy the way he or she did before. We don't see investment rising in any significant way now. The hope is that the removal of the uncertainty regarding trade will ignite investment in Canada. I don't think it will happen. So that's the reason why we believe that it's not a stretch to expect the Bank of Canada actually to cut interest rates in 2020, maybe April, maybe May, maybe June, to cut interest rates in order to stimulate the economy, maybe consumption, and more so to lower the value of the dollar to stimulate exports. That's a guess, but that's basically our guess regarding what the Bank of Canada will be doing. So to go back to your question, we don't have too many drivers, unfortunately, and that's why economic growth in 2020 will be nothing to write home about.
That dollar that you're referring to, our dollar, is hovering around that 75 cents U.S. mark. And I'm wondering whether or not the forecast, an expected projected forecast, is that 75 cent mark for the year.
Yes, I think the consensus is about 75. I think it will be a bit lower because the Bank of Canada would like to see it lower. I think this is a bank with an agenda. The agenda is a weaker Canadian dollar. They would like to see the Canadian dollar going down, not only against the American currency, more so against other currencies that we compete against in the U.S. market, against the yen, against the euro, even the Chinese yuan. Why? Because we have been losing market share in a significant way in the American market to those countries. And we need to see our dollar going down in order to reestablish ourselves as a force in this space. It's not happening. And I think that the dollar is a solution. I think that the Bank of Canada knows that. So if they cut by 25 basis points and keep the market guessing about another cut, that will weaken the value of the dollar, or at least will prevent the dollar from rising. And that's exactly what the Bank of Canada would like to see.
Earlier in this conversation, you had mentioned the U.S. President, Donald Trump, who is set to propose a $4.8 trillion budget in an election year. And I guess that's based on U.S. economic growth of about 2.8%, eventually, I guess, at 3% in 2021. How will this affect Canada? Does it affect Canada?
Well, first of all, he's proposing. He's not going to get it. Congress will not allow it to go ahead. So it's not going to happen. So those numbers are nice to campaign on, and he will do it. So he will run the elections using those numbers, but he will not be getting them because Congress will not allow it to happen. So that's the starting point. Nevertheless, he has the green light to spend, and he's going to spend as much as he can in 2020. We will see a lot of money going to defense and all kinds of other, maybe tax cuts, what he calls tax cut 2.0. We'll see. If you look at fiscal policy as a whole in 2020, it basically will be neutral in the U.S. It will not be a huge amount of money being spent and stimulating the economy. Whatever it is, however, it is not as negative as it could have been, and therefore it is positive for Canada, because in Canada, fiscal stimulus will be relatively muted compared to what you're going to see in the U.S. So the impact on GDP will not be very significant. So whatever they spend, we will benefit from. However, we have to remember they're spending money that they don't have. This means that there will be increased vulnerability, especially to higher interest rates down the road. But for now, they will do it.
Anything that is on your, I guess, that's top of mind for you that perhaps we're not seeing, that we are focusing on, but that's maybe making headlines for you that we should be focusing on?
Well, there are a few things that, you never know. But for example, the housing market. We see a nice recovery in the housing market, especially in the condo space in places like Toronto and Vancouver. I suggest that maybe it's moving a bit too fast in Toronto, this recovery, especially in the condo space. I will be a bit careful about what's happening there over the next year or two, the next even few months, in terms of supply and demand and how much is being built and for what price. That's one thing. The other is, which is interesting, we might be seeing a wave of people coming back to Canada, Canadian citizens that live abroad that come back to Canada, and less people live in Canada. Because, look at Hong Kong, the U.S., Brexit, a lot of things happening that will prevent the motivation to leave Canada and will increase the motivation to come back to Canada. Stats Canada, the government, we simply don't know how many people are living abroad, how many people are coming on a daily, monthly basis, yearly basis. We simply don't know. So it's possible that all those people are coming back, returning citizens, and we simply don't know that. That can have a significant impact on demand in the economy, and we're simply blind to it, something that we have to look at.